colleagues, friends, extended professional family, I welcome you to this joint Women in Aerospace and IDEA 3G breakfast. My name is Barbara Ingo, and I'm the treasurer of Women in Aerospace Europe, and also the director for corporate identity. And I'm very honored to lead you through our program this morning. Christiane Lechtenberger sends her apologies. She couldn't come, so I will be substituting for her. We thank IDEA for partnering with us on this event. Today's topic is set against the conference theme of a key for unlocking imagination, fostering innovation, and strengthening security. And this is set against the theme of gender, geography, generation, and interdisciplinarity. So unlocking imagination, what does it mean? It means to dare, it means to take risk. It means to go an extra mile. It means probably a little bit similar to fostering innovation. You have to dare to go a little bit further and to take risks. And then strengthening security. So now do you think this is a contradiction to taking a risk and being daring, or can this be in line with fostering this imagination and innovation? So we're going to talk about this in the context of gender diverse space workforce. We have gathered a couple of exciting speakers who will give an impulse talk, a short talk on their point of view. As an introduction, I'd like to ask Christina Gianopapa, Women in Aerospace Director for Professional Development, to speak and to introduce us to this morning. She's representing our President, Lucella Giulichi. Christina, welcome.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you all for taking the time to come so early this morning when we are also arriving towards the second part of the week. Very much appreciated. So let's see. Diversity for me is something that has been changing and evolving over time, has not been static, and what it represents and how people have been fighting for it. So the first era of diversity was about women fighting to get vote, to have the possibility to vote, and at the same time to be able to represent themselves in the parliament and in the public. And it is a great pleasure to be here today in Australia, because Australia was the first country in the world that provided the possibility for women to write and stand in parliament. And it was here in South Australia. So very proud to have this possibility. The second era of diversity was the time where women started trying to climb themselves into the ladder of professional, career. And we have, over the past period, been able to become prime ministers, chancellors, represent the society in the highest levels where decisions are made. So our voice has also been heard. And also in the space sector. Space is not anymore toys for boys, it also toys for girls. And we had the pleasure to have seen Pascal Ehrenfreund becoming the top person in DLR. And also in UN OSA, we have Simonetta Di Pipo, our honorary president, who is the second woman after the Prima Slam Otman from Malaysia that also had this top job. But what is the next step? What does diversity mean now? For me, diversity is many, many more things. It's not only STEM, so engaging women in science, engineering, mathematics, and other disciplines, and to increase their numbers into career progression in top managerial jobs. This has changed. It is about inclusiveness. It's about bringing the benefits that are there. I very much like this picture. This picture for me represents diversity 3.0. And you might be thinking that the reason why this picture is there is because of President Macron of France, who is one of the most powerful men today in the world. And he's representing young people and fresh ideas and a different perspective. But that's not the reason. Next to him is our president of the International Astronautical Federation, Jean-Yves Le Gall, who has been one of the first presidents to put diversity in light at the top of his agenda. So it is a great pleasure to be part of IDEA and to have the possibility to exchange. And all of this would have never happened without having Lena Feichtinger, and I would like at this point that I point out that Lena Feichtinger has been our executive director in Women in Aerospace and contributed quite a lot in diversity and has dedicated her life to it, and she is a pillar also for IDEA. So may I ask you all for a round of applause for Lena Feichtinger. Vice President, our Mary Snitch, who is one of the most prominent women walking around here and has been always supportive in lots of different ways. So, diversity 3.0, it cannot go without having the fundamental support of the top management. The top management in the CEOs of companies, in universities, and in particular, the heads of the space agencies. So it is a pleasure to see the Professor Battiston and also Pascal Ehrenfreund and our own Jan Werner from the European Space Agency, who has been supporting diversity and participating in all of these WIA breakfasts over the past couple of years, from the beginning. So, diversity for, we'll go one step back, oops. Okay. So I will say that diversity for WIA is that we envision a world for which the Europeans and also other nations have the possibility to collaborate together in an inclusive representation. And it is very important to also show that everybody has different background. And we're going to have also one of our speakers, Sarah here, who will give us her own perspective about it. So WIA is an association which brings together interested members, and we have more than 600 members in our association in Europe. We have more than 20 sponsors, and we would like to thank them also for providing us the possibility to organize events like this. And additionally, we have lots of local groups, so everybody interested can get engaged in Europe in the different locations. So next year we will try also to work together with IDEA, and we have discussed with President Le Gall about the possibility of looking together and putting together a policy on diversity that the corporate members can benefit for. So let's do this together. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Christina, for the introduction. I can already see the diversity 3.0, space 4.0, so let's go and grab it. Our next speaker is Jean-Yves Le Gall, the president of the IAF, and as we heard, one of the promoters of diversity and also the front person of IDEA. So I'd like to ask you now for your introductory words. Please come onto stage.
President Macron. It's a quite interesting story because, as you know, he has been elected nearly May. He took his office, I think, the 20th of May, and as a matter of fact, the 2nd of June, Thomas Pesquet, the European astronaut with a French accent, no Parisian, but yeah, okay, came back from the station, and it was in the afternoon, and the day before, President Macron called me because he wanted to attend the live broadcast of the return, and so he came to this. And it was quite funny because he wanted to speak with Thomas Pesquet just after he landed, but as usual in this kind of circumstances, the live link with Baikonur didn't work. And by chance, we had in Baikonur someone from ESA with phone working with satellite, and we have been successful in allowing President Macron to speak with Thomas Pesquet a few minutes after he landed. And so globally it has been a success, but it has been a little bit tricky. So this picture has an history. I tried to smile, but I was a little bit nervous about the link with Baikonur. Okay. As president of EIAF, I'm very pleased to welcome you this morning for this networking event dedicated to the promotion of diversity in the space sector. This is a joint IAF, WAI Europe Diversity Breakfast, and using our IAF platform ID. I would like just to say a few words about the fruitful relations between EIAF and WAI Europe, and this history is very closely connected to one very special person with unfortunately is not with us anymore, Mrs. Andrea Bosé, because Andrea, as you know, was DLR Chief Diversity Officer and WAI Europe Director for International Relations since the creation of the organization, and also as IAF Vice President, she was passionate about diversity. And she was the organizer of the WAI Europe Breakfast at past ISCs, and she did a lot for what we are going to discuss this morning, and probably she paved the way for diversity, and at the beginning, as usual, she was the only one to speak about that. And today, what is quite surprising and on another point, an excellent thing is that diversity now is on the top of the agenda of space organizations, but also space industries. Because it is clear that it is a point which is very, very important. And we signed so memorandum of understanding between IAF and WAI Europe at the ISC 2015 in Jerusalem. About the breakfast of this morning, the title is Gender Diverse Space Workforce, Key for Unlocking Imagination, Fostering Innovation, and Strengthening Security. And this clearly shows the importance of one of the three G diversity aspects, namely gender diversity, to be a very timely theme of this 6th ISC. It has always been one of the IAF mission to help prepare the space workforce of tomorrow. And this workforce must be obviously a diverse workforce in geography, diverse in generations, and also diverse specifically in gender. But it is not only the IAF mission, it is and it has to be high on the agenda of all leaders in our space community. And I am very happy that some of the key leaders of space organizations are with us this morning to discuss about this issue. And so I want to thank very much Pascal Rentfrain, chair of the DLR Executive Board, and I am Vice President Roberto Battiston, President of the Italian Space Agency, also IAF Vice President. Sarah John Pell, an Australian artist. Congratulations, because I saw what you are doing. It's very refreshing, I just say. And I understand that you are a professional diver. It's normal in Australia. And I will need to dive with you on the Great Barrier. And last but not least, also, we have with us Ian Werner, that everybody knows. So, finally, I would like to welcome our IAF Vice President for Diversity Initiatives, Mary Snitch, who has made an outstanding effort to make this gender breakfast today happen, and she will round up the discussions and provide closing remarks. I would like also, I would like to close by encouraging all IAF member organizations to follow this example of WI Europe and use our ID platform to arrange events promoting the 3G diversity principle around the globe and take concrete steps to create a diverse space community at all levels. And I think that see, we have many social networks you can connect with us. So once again, welcome, enjoy the presentations, enjoy discussions, enjoy the networking, and I think that it's not just because it's in the air, these questions of diversity. I think that it is a very, very serious issue, and the fact that we are so numerous makes me very optimistic for on what we have to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your introductory words. I'm very susceptible to inspirational talks. So many years ago at a conference at ESTEC, for the first time I heard a truly stimulating talk about astrobiology. Coming from architecture myself and getting introduced to a completely other, to me at that time, hardly known discipline by a woman, deeply impressed me. And I immediately thought that we actually need more of that topic and more, you know, of women like her. So this scientist with quite an outstanding scientific career then was, of course, Pascal Ehrenfreund, chair of the DLR executive board today. So have we achieved a gender diverse workforce already? Pascal, please come onto stage and continue the conversation.
Hello, good morning. I'm an astronomer and I feel only well at 7 o'clock when I'm still awake. My voice is also in that sense always very early in the morning. But I really appreciate that we are doing this and that we are always coming together. And I want to give you a few numbers, a few slides. We are a very, very large organization, and that makes, of course, this whole gender diversity is a problematic thing, and you really have to tackle it because not all is up to an organization. It's actually a chain of many things which makes a change in the whole diversity scheme. So we are now over 8,000 employees, I want to show you some numbers. This is a little bit less because we have just we added one institute with 200 people, so that's why you see the numbers are a little bit under 8,000. We haven't made the mass up between this one, but you can see that from our workforce there are 2,500 women compared to 5,500 men. And then when you look into leadership position, it gets already rather dramatic, I would say. And this is something one has to work. But the next picture, I think, is more important. And you can see about academic degrees in STEM subjects and in administration. And I know this is a lot of color and a lot of numbers very early in the morning, but when you imagine you have about 5,000 people which have an academic degree at DLR, you see that it is equal when you look at the last chart in the administrative sector. But when you look into the science and the R&D degrees, you can see that there is a really, really big difference. And that is actually something which we have to cope with. And every organization has, of course, its measures and guidelines. And we have also just reorganized in DLR, and we have a group and department which works on diversity and sustainability. But still, it is a chain, and we are just one part of it. And even when you don't have enough students in the subjects, then we also are not able to get enough women into the R&D sector. And I have to say that in space research, that's actually quite equilibrated. However, for instance, in our aeronautics research, it is really, really, really critical. So you see this kind of balance, and you see that women also choose, particularly in Germany, academic degrees in administration. And it is a really important thing in order to foster more women in the STEM sector, but of course also in leadership positions. And that's what we are trying to do with some kind of measures. And we have a lot of, this goes a little bit too fast, we have a lot of workshops and activities. And I have to say that I am the chair of the LR, and I have many different additional colleagues in the board. They are all male, but they are really, really doing the best they can, and have each of them their special measures in space, in aeronautics, and in energy and transportation. And some of those approaches are regular workshops, at least twice a year, where they already discuss also the topic of leading positions, where we are openly discussing what is the problems, you know, how can you actually manage a career and family life together. And we always also invite, of course, external speakers and rectors of universities, presidents of universities, females, of course, and which give an example and talk also about their measures in their own organization, and try also to give them confidence. And you have a lot of subjects which are touched in that, because it's mostly also about giving confidence and giving the idea that you can handle it, and you can handle family, and you can handle work, and that you also can, for instance, share leadership positions. This is something what is discussed very much in our subjects of aeronautics and space, that they have the possibility when they are group leader in order to share the position, so two women, and having a flexible time schedule. So there is something which is actually implemented in old Germany and also in other countries, and this is when you have evaluation committees, and that you have at least a percentage of 30% of women. And this is really something which is a starting point. It is really important that you have a critical mass in every advisory boards in order to really to take up the matters of women and discuss that. And I've talked already about the job sharing, the leadership position. This is a model which in particular space or space sector is trying to do. And we have also a special program for funding junior research groups and professorships. Many of them are women. This is something what we really try to record. We have now introduced last year quotas, you know, which are mandatory. And if those quotas are not met, then there are financial measures. So then money is reduced in the different institutes. That was not extremely popular, but my colleagues have really made progress on that. Because it is also that you have, in order to go out and try really to find women, this is, you have always all your measures also in communication and how you actually write notices of appointments. All that makes the language, makes already how you advertise and how you present your organization makes, of course, a very big difference in order to attract women. And I think that is something really important. We won a lot of awards, but we can do more. And I don't want to go in all of them, but we are trying really hard. We have now a department is really taking care of that with 5 or 6 people, and there are many of those awards which we are trying to fulfill since many years, and we are always including that. But apart from that, you always know that you have to do more. And one initiative is of course something which got a lot of attention. This is the Astronautin, and Mrs. Kessler is not here, unfortunately, but she could explain you much more. But she initiated this field of the German Astronautin, yeah? And since we had 11 astronauts, but not one female in Germany, and there have been really 400 very enthusiastic candidates, 6 finalists. And as you have probably read in the press, there have been two women, really top women, selected. Insa Thiele Eich, which is the daughter of an astronaut, of course, and Nicola Baumann, she is a jet pilot from the German army. And they are all really quite fascinating. Also the others which you see here. And we contributed with our medical research facilities during the selection process, and are somehow a little bit involved by offering parabolic flights, you know, for some of the candidates. And that made a lot of, and I think Mrs. Kessler is really continuing with this initiative, and it is something which is extremely popular. And I just want to finish with our school labs. This is actually where you have to start. You have really to start much more early, because you have seen the bottleneck is that we have not enough women in the STEM subjects, and we have not enough women which are graduating in R&D subjects, which then could actually go further and also take up leadership positions. And in this DLR school labs, there are 30 now all over Germany. We are of course training and trying to get a lot of school kids inspired. And here we have already a better balance. 60% of them are male and 40% are female students, and you see how this is rising over the years. There's big interest. About 40,000 students are going through the school labs per year. They are booked out in advance, and here you have really the chance in order to also already inspire the young girls for their future career in R&D. And there are some numbers. And we have also special girls' days, you know, where we really you see here also even our chancellor, you know, taking interest in that was I think our school lab in Köln boards, and working with the kids. And this is one of the ways where you can actually really start early, which you can also do as an organization. But obviously there is a lot of more measures which you have to take from country-wise and other organizations. One organization alone can never, you know, get through this chain that you have enough women in the STEM sector, but and also in encourage them, you know, in order to go further. So I think I'm done. That's more or less what I wanted to say. I think it takes a village. We are trying to do and trying to improve that. Also, I have to say that I have 40 institutes directors, and right now there is only one which is female. Yeah, and this is also something which we have to change. And with retirements, we have really to look for excellent female candidates in the future. And we have all to do our share. We try to do a lot, but we can actually only do it together with a whole program in the entire country with other organizations. And I think it's important to have this kind of meetings where you actually exchange. And obviously also in every country it's different. And it is important to learn from each other and then try to improve in your own organization and exchange also in political advisory boards, these kind of opinions to make the whole chain really valuable. Thank you very much.
Talk with a lot of facts and also some options for making conscious strategic choices for women, increasing diversity, sharing leaderships, and you know, creating workshops. I'm always surprised in my many travels through Europe to meetings that I often meet a lot of Italian female space engineers. And they seem to be more than, you know, others from other countries. So I wonder if that's true, and if yes, then why? And I hope our next speaker, Roberto Battistone, the president of the Italian Space Agency, will shed light on this. Welcome, Roberto Battistone.
Good morning to everybody. tonight I was making very late hours also myself because our Minister of Education, which is a woman, Valeria Ferreri, announced that the fourth gravitational wave event, which has been observed 1st of August, is being seen by the three interferometers, including the one in Europe, which is a French Italian interferometer in Pisa, Cascina, which can pinpoint now the origin of a gravitational wave to an accuracy which is about 150 times more precise than in the past. So gravitational wave astronomy is really starting very strong. I say that also because I'm proud about that, but also because within ESA there is a very strong program about gravitational waves observation in space, and this scientific result make really a very powerful message to everybody of us. And I was very proud to have our minister, Valeria Ferreri, announcing that tonight. So this has nothing to do with this specific topic which has been announced, but I felt it was a good point to make because this is belonging to science and to everybody of us. What about Italian Space Agency and women? We can move on the next slide, please. I can do myself, sorry, yeah, thank you. So the question, why there are so many women in engineering, no also in science in general, not all sciences, but most sciences, physics for instance. I recall Fabiola Gianotti, which is the director of CERN in Geneva, is clearly a very prominent figure, and many others. I don't know, it's a fact which is not resulting from specific gender-oriented measures, it's a fact that we are observing, which is a positive fact. In Italian Space Agency in particular, we have a ratio between total number of employees. You can see the numbers here are much smaller, with one order of magnitude smaller, maybe one and a half one smaller than one in DLR. Italian Space Agency is organized in a different way. It's a small agency which is driving industry and research centers and companies through investment and contracts. So it's a different organization. Nevertheless, a good fraction of our employees is basically most of them, with a small margin, are women. And this is applied both for the administrative but also the technological sector. If you look to the women in the first line, we have 7 head of units, 725 head of offices, which is basically the same ratio as for the total number of employees. So, as a matter of fact, this is a gender balanced sharing within the Italian Space Agency. And there are also some primes. Our Director General in ASI, this lady on the left, on your left, Anna Sirica, is the first Director General in Italy of a large research organization, and she has an extended experience in other science organizations, in the astronomy, INAF, in the nuclear physics, INFN, and also in the agricultural research unit, CRR, and so is uniquely capable and competent for dealing with the complex law which deals with the public sector in Italy. You cannot imagine how complex it is to deal with this kind of infinite amount of rules, regulation, and boundaries, and she's performing that very, very effectively. And so I think, from this point of view, ASI is really giving a good sign also to the other organization in Italy. So if I do that, we move on. And also because we have a woman as a director general, she has taken very seriously a number of measures to help gender balanced professional activity within ASI. This is our creche, nido, how to say that in English, kindergarten. This is Germany, okay. It is a beautiful one, recently inaugurated. You could say that it's quite normal to have this within organization in research in Europe. Yes, but in Italy it's the first one. It's the first one within a research organization all over Italy. And that's a clearly a strong signal which is being given. And this is open since ASI is located in the neighborhood of Rome. I mean, is also giving the opportunity to the women from the University of Roma Tor Vergata, the second university in Rome, as well to the local village where we are close by, to get support for the early stage, up to 3 years, kindergarten services. We have also a part-time teleworking project, which involves about 20 employees altogether, which is a very important one for women who has a small child or which has issues about older parents and needs like that. And this is a very concrete measure which was quite a challenge to put together and to start because, as just mentioned before, the laws were there, the resources were there, but to make it happen took only the intelligent, insistent, and the goal-oriented approach of our Director General, Anna Sirica. Among various things which we do to promote a gender balance approach to the professional career in science, in particular in space. We have chosen various movies to be presented sometime for the first time in Italy to our public. In particular, was a very successful one, The Hidden Figures, which has been projected during the ASI Space Cinema Film Festival, which has seen the Minister of Education and Research, Valeria Fedeli, participating to us together with the Secretary Elena Buschi. It's been a very extraordinary opportunity to show and explain, based on historical facts and the beautiful movie, how women were important not only for developing science, space science, in the early phases in the United States, but also in maintaining and supporting and letting civil rights to become a reality in a gender and race unbalanced world. And this was really a very interesting, important moment, and the minister was very proud about that, and she was instrumental in making this particular movie available and distributed in the schools to provide information and models for the new generation. And another measure which has been taken is to have a permanent exhibition of the exhibition Space Girls, Space Women, which you know very well because I think you were instrumental, some of you were instrumental to putting it together. So all our visitors which enter ASI have the opportunity to pass through an alley where this beautiful tableau, beautiful photographs are shown. And as you know, there are several, tens of women which have achieved important results all over the place in the research chain, in different countries, in different organizations, not only astronauts, but engineers, young, future, career-oriented women. Finally, I will take this opportunity also to thank a person, which is a woman, extremely professional, capable woman, which is Dr. Gabriella Rigo, which is here with us today. Everybody knows Gabriella because as head of the International Relations Unit over many, many years in ASI, has really contributed a lot to the network of relation, the friendship, and the strong collaboration with many different countries, agencies. For this reason, I think she's a very good candidate for one of the position of Vice President of IAF Bureau, which I hope will be a decision taken tonight, this morning, at the meeting we are going to have. And I think she deserves our support and applause for all the work she did for so many years. Thank you so much.
For the Italian perspective. Now it is an honor we will hear from Sarah Jane Kerr, Australian artist, researcher, and occupational diver. Sarah's background does not lie in the conventional space discipline of disciplines of engineering, policy, law, or science. And she comes from a country that has just founded its own space agency. Yet, she has been consequently following her dream of becoming an artist astronaut candidate. Please welcome Sarah Jane Pell on stage.
I would like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land and to pay my respects to their elders past, present, and future. To many of you, Australia is that enormous southern continent far, far, far away. For some some of you, we are an ancient Asian nation, and for others, we are a young Western nation. But here in Australia, we say that we are the lucky country, that we are one and that we are many. We don't take life too seriously, and we value mateship above all. So as we are at the outset of establishing a space agency here in Australia, I think it's important to reevaluate some of our identity values, because perhaps they're in fact a barrier to our maturity in space. So let me explain why. Spending time with the Aboriginal elders on my mother's country has taught me that the custodianship of country, culture, community, and cosmology are intricately and equally linked to the longevity and health of humanity. Now, they achieve this by practicing black sky thinking, multi-generational governance and consultation, and asset management through strategic planning and forecasting some 100 years in the future. So when I think about diversity, I compare models of leadership to this proven and effective, sustainable and enduring model of diversity, cooperation and inclusion. Yet, with our recent history, we see that this remains untapped, invisible, and even a demeaned asset. And the message is clear, that the phrase, the lucky country, is a term for the whitefella. It is essential that Australia literally reinvigorates and investigates the term of national agency. Who are we and how do we enable? How do we go from a nation that prides itself on being grounded and lift off, raise the bar for everyone? How is it that we promote not just our mates, but we build cultural relationships from the outset that unite and empower women, Indigenous, LGBTQ+, cultural and religious, generational and mature age, disability access, and transdisciplinary access to space? Let us help be a part of a movement that calls all space actors to promote a broader view of effective leadership, one that promotes a variety of demographic backgrounds, as we've seen, and a variety of leadership styles, both introverted and extroverted, and in fact, a flexibility of working styles, both conventional and unconventional. And let us work together to seek to dissolve the divisions to ensure that our diversity and inclusion initiatives involve equal and active partnerships between men and women, people from culturally diverse backgrounds and those who are not, actively and equally cooperating to be advocates, role models, and change agents. This is a new opportunity to remind ourselves that gender diversity is a business issue, not a women's issue. That here at the IAC and events like this where we come together, that we can collect and report on diversity and inclusion leadership metrics, that we can educate each other about and acknowledge the differences between us without stereotyping, and encouraging everyone to challenge the gender bias in our organizational policies and practices, perhaps hashtagging the all-male panel, promoting women to leadership roles. And ladies, let's make it easy. Let's step up, speak up, sit at the table, support, sponsor, and shepherd each other, and above all, value our contributions and ourselves in these discussions. Now, I've arrived at space from a slightly different perspective. I've worked in interdisciplinary, intercultural, and international teams to bring together a diverse perspective
on my approach to human spaceflight in extreme environments. And I began life as a commercial diver, working in high-risk operational environments, usually as the only woman, usually in workplaces that didn't even have a female toilet. Working to understand how we perform, how we behave, how we work with crews, and how we can bring some of the poetics of that human experience to a land-based audience by combining performing arts practice with a commercial diving approach. So I was beginning to explore the intersections between art and science to build a unique practice and approach. So I could critique something of the limited air supply that we have here on Earth and some of the human experiences that we are facing and some of the challenges that we are here to solve with our space activities. And also those beautiful, magical moments where we can dream and imagine living, behaving, working, even flying and falling in these altered gravity conditions of space. So I call myself a designer of extreme architectures and on a mission for Bending Horizons. Let's just introduce some of that work. Could I get some sound, please? Sadly, there's beautiful sound to that. So this Bending Horizons mission is an adapted business model to disrupt space exploration maps. It began by combining this commercial diving, but then beginning to work in space analog environments, underwater, at high altitude, in extreme remote locations. I perform a range of interrelated projects to challenge the long-held views about the kind of architectures that can be innovated upon, and to strategically deploy these and publish across domains, including the arts, sciences, humanities, and engineering and technology platforms. So as you can see, I'm using creativity as a vehicle to space. And I'm here because of your vision, your courage, and your dreams, and I'm deeply grateful that you, in fact, are my muse. So as Jacques Arnold said, ethicist to the French Space Agency said, space represents all. It's an abstract idea, a physical area or environment, as well as a tool employed in the social experience. So any unconscious thinking that we have is a prior or a pattern recognition, and these systems are inherently stable. They're perpetuated by the status quo. So in order to disrupt them, we need a change is required. I attempt to do that through interdisciplinary approaches to issues in human spaceflight preparation. But similarly, a pattern of bias associations that forms our stereotypes is not to be altered until a critical mass of contradictory information is overt. So while these kinds of practices occur in isolation, as artists, as scientists, as engineers, men, women, and other, working together in space, we build upon these diverse frameworks of understanding, and we share our tools for investigative processes. And by jointly stepping into new worlds and territories together, be they virtual, actual, on a day-to-day basis, or over a long period of time, if we enter into those spaces with common purpose, with mutual respect for curiosity, there emerges new opportunities for encounters that offer us all a new perspective. So as you architect new dreams and boldly explore new frontiers in search of answers and resources, find the inner resources to be a champion of women, to be open to true diversity, to be a part of open source space, and an advocate for positive inclusion. It is time for new energies. It is time for new languages and new ideas to match the radical technological advancements and the entrepreneurial fervor that we're seeing in space through openness, collaboration, transdisciplinarity, and respect for all. Thank you. Thank you very much, Sarah, for this inspiring talk. Before Mary Stitch is concluding the event, we will have Jan Werner, ESA Director General, now to wrap up and give us an other perspective.
Okay. Okay. So at the same time, Mercury 13, which is not so well known, was developed with 13 female astronauts. None of them ever flew. By the way, one of them came in my office, and I did not know that it's her. Last year, suddenly there was a lady, and at the end of the day, it was one of these 13 Mercury females. The stereotypes, you were talking, no, I have to go back. You are talking about stereotypes. This is a stereotype of the 60s, the computer girls. They were just there to type in what others were thinking. And as Roberto was saying, The Hidden Figure, a very nice movie, is taking up this very special stereotype. So even behind the curtain, they were the ones securing the launch of John Glenn and others. The situation of females in our business in different fields is still not a convincing one. Women in research fields 22%, and patents filed by women only 13%. So one could say, ah, they are not as inventive as men. But it's the same as what I observed always, and Andrea Böse was the one who told me that, if you have a vacancy note, then men are just saying, okay, there is a position for a president, I apply. While females are looking into the full vacancy note and read each and every requirement. You have to be international, you have to have some experience over here, some experience over there. And then they say, ah, I don't fulfill all 100%, so I better do not apply. While men, in general terms, say, okay, president is a nice job. And this is maybe also the same with the situation of patents. Yes, I also applied several times for patents, some successful, some others. I even did not check before whether some other already invented that. I checked, okay, just I put a file on the desk. Maybe this is also the difference. Okay, Portugal is the world champion with about 26% of patents filed by women. I'm mentioning always the issue of space 4.0, and in space 4.0 also the diversity is of course one aspect which has to be considered, and which should be considered as a chance, as an opportunity, as an asset. Because of time, I will not talk about the diverse activities of ESA. I would like to go forward And one thing is, you know, we have the European Union, we are far away from there here. Europe was thinking about the United States of Europe, which is also a diverse activity. However, it's far away, so what we can do at least is United Space in Europe. And this is then the picture over here. So Europe from space is borderless. The only thing you can observe over here, which is a little bit challenging, is some clouds above UK. So this is something which gives us some headache at these times. But again, United Space in Europe is something also about diversity, because we have not only different countries, but I can tell you really, people from the northern part of Europe and people from the southern part of Europe are working in a different way, and this is the beauty in ESA, that we have both at the same time working in the same environment. I have some problem with it. Yeah, so, but diversity should be even beyond that. So diversity is not only a question of nationality, of course, geographic, as Jean-Yves is always saying. For us, it's also a diversity of institutions. For instance, between the European Union and ESA, these are two very diverse and very different organizations. Diversity is also about that. But I will come also to the question of men and women. Diversity for me, in a global sense, means also to take into account all the different nations worldwide and their specific possibilities. Just a final remark, because before I come again to the female aspect, diversity for me is also to take into account physically challenged people or mentally challenged people, because they have a different view, and this different view gives you some additional aspect. But we should give also something back, and what we did over here, we made a zero-G flight with physically challenged people, kids, but also adults, even some people paralyzed from the neck downwards, and for them it was a great experience. And we can learn from them also how to handle day by day's life. So this was a very special experience. And you see here, we had some astronauts with us, Timothy Peake, European astronaut with a British accent, and some others, and the young people, and also the other one were floating. I tell this because just when I was sitting here, I got an invitation from one of them for his birthday party. And I thought, okay, I should include at least one picture of them in this. Because we are not as big as DLR is, we have less staff, but we wanted to know exactly what are the wishes of our staff in order to take into account the diverse wishes of all the people in ESA. And we did what we call a staff engagement survey. We asked them about very different things. And out of that, there came a clear thing we have to do. And as you can see here, there's also diversity was one part. And then we decided two directors who should take care of this aspect. And coming out of that was that we changed a little bit the wording. We're using now diversity and inclusiveness. And the idea and the meaning is, and you mentioned it also as well, that it's not only to talk about diversity, to have 20 nations working in the same institution, or female and male working in the same institution, or different backgrounds working in the same institution, you have to connect them. Only then you get the asset you want to have. So therefore the inclusiveness should mean that we are taking them at the same time, in the same working arrangement, to get some assets out of that. So it's not a question of how should I say, being nice to them. It's the other way around. It is to take the assets, and therefore we also defined Chief Diversity Officer as Ilya Wouda, who is taking care of these things, not only male and female, but all the different types of possibilities. You all heard about the Apollo effect, of course. Apollo effect was that when Kennedy initiated his program, that during the next years, the PhDs in engineering and physical science and even in math were increasing dramatically. So the Apollo program was over here with the first landing of a man on the moon. And it was really a dramatic change also in the society. So there was the Apollo effect. Everybody knows about it. And it was a very much male-dominated thing. What we have to know who Apollo was, I hope you know it. It was the Greek goddess, as you see it over here. There's Greek god. And the question is, what will be the first woman on the moon? What will be the effect of her on Earth? And I think my understanding is we have Apollo, and we have his twin, which is Artemis. She is the goddess and god of women and children. So I hope that through the first woman on the moon, we will get not only an Apollo effect, but then also an Artemis effect, so that the past is changing through the Artemis effect to something better, also with the relation between the contribution of male and female. Coming back to that, I would like to repeat also the understanding. So for me, it's very important that the 3G diversity is not a neutral aspect. It is also not generously tolerant, but proactively using diversity and inclusiveness as the instrument to take advantage of different personalities, having different backgrounds, different views, and different competencies. So it is, from my perspective, it is a big asset for an institution and not something just to be nice or to show that one is active in that field. It is an asset. Okay, another person said that in much better words. And this was, I hope it comes now. Again, I have the problem. Ooh, that is Mahatma Gandhi. He said, our ability to reach unity and diversity will be the beauty and the test of our civilization. With that, I conclude my presentation. I thank you very much.
Hello. Thank you very much, Jan Werner, for this very uplifting talk. Diversity in geography disciplines, institutions, physically, mentally challenged and challenged people, gender and generations. And with this, I'd like to also welcome Alexis and her brother or sister over there. It's already the next generation and hopefully already the second generation to step on the moon and not on the first one again. So last I'd like to invite Mary Snitch before we head off to further conversations and more coffee, the IF Vice President for Diversity Initiatives. And I actually forgot to say I'd like to thank the DLR for providing nutrition and fuel to us this morning. Okay, now Mary, please, stay with yours.
So I've invited Kevin and Jessica to bring Alexa up to help me with the closing remarks. And as you can see here on Thursday of the week, my voice is almost gone, along with yours, Pascal is much better than mine. but this has been a wonderful morning with wonderful speakers for such an important topic that we are already talking in this Congress about how to make the study of and the advocacy of diversity much more important and much more at the front of the stage for Bremen. So yesterday,
this is our friends.
Yesterday morning, at our diversity breakfast, our 3G idea diversity breakfast, we talked about, as John Werner alluded to, we had an audience exercise regarding who is going to be, what is the person going to look like who next steps on the moon, and what is the first woman on the moon going to look like. And we talked about, I'll make this short. We talked about where, what nation is that first woman going to come from? Will she be, will the first woman, as she steps on the moon, be part of the next generation? And how quickly is that first woman going to step on the moon? So yesterday afternoon at the GNF on diversity that was organized by We Are Europe, I had the wonderful chance meeting going into the hall of meeting this young girl, ninth grade, who came up to me and said, "I want to be an astronaut." And so I think horribly embarrassed her by asking if I could introduce her publicly to the GNF audience, which she was very gracious to allow me to do. Well, I think, and her name was Sarah Carstens, and I introduced her as possibly the first woman on the moon. I would now like to introduce Alexa as maybe the second woman on the moon, or certainly a next woman in space. And so I think we ought to welcome her. And with that, the formal part of the breakfast closes. Please continue to network, have more coffee before you go off to your first session. Thank you very much.